Let's stand together and sing this.
Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. O perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer, the promise of God, the vilest offender, who truly rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done.
Praise the Lord,
praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus.
pray with me. Lord Jesus, we love you. We worship you this morning. We want to sense your presence. We want to be close to you. And God, we know that the only thing that would hinder us from being intimate with you today is our own pride, our own sinfulness. It's a wall. And so, God, I pray that we would have a vision of your grace and mercy this morning, and that we would draw close to you because you are already drawing close to us. Thank you for the abundant life, Lord, that you promise us that we can experience here. Thank you, Lord, for the hope of heaven. Thank you for the opportunities that you give us every day to shine your light and to be salt on the earth. Help us to not be focused on ourselves. Help us to have our focus on you and on others. And God, help us to have an attitude of gratefulness, Lord, in a very ungrateful, evil world. And Lord Jesus, in your powerful name, we stand against the schemes of the devil. He lies and he cheats. He brings about confusion. And there's a lot of it around. But I know, Lord, that you promise that your truth will prevail. And so we are faithful to you. And we cry out to you in our time of need. We pray for your healing touch. We pray that you would mend every broken heart. We pray that you would expose the things that need to be exposed. And God, that we would understand what a graceful and loving and wonderful God you are. In your name I pray. Amen. So good to see you. You may be seated and welcome. And I want to begin our time together. We're celebrating a very special anniversary, if I can find the person. Where is Tony? There you are, Tony. I was looking back there for you. Come on up here, girl. Can y'all believe that today, Tony, let me put my mask on here, celebrates 5 years with us here at First Baptist Gilmer. She's been running the office and running the church. You didn't know that, did you? And yeah, some people do, but we love Tony, appreciate everything that she does, and we want to, first off, I want you just to express your heartfelt thanks to her for all the wonderful work that she does for us. And we have a present for you, and you can open that right now. Thank you. Tony types my sermons for me, and I have the worst handwriting you've ever seen. And she is a professional. It is. She's a professional at deciphering my handwriting. She is. Sometimes with a little help from Karen.
Yes.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Did you tell them what it is? Oh, I should have a microphone.
It's a Fitbit.
It's a Fitbit. She's got a smart watch, okay, so she can keep up with herself and all of us.
You can't say anything in the church office that isn't repeated. But thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Tony, very much. We appreciate you. All right. Let me mention a few other things to you. First off, I want to mention to you that it's just next weekend that we have our retreat, that our students are going just across the border to Camp Bethany, $35 a student, leaving, I guess it's this Friday. Where's Brandon sitting at? Okay. Huh? Friday? Is it Friday? And be back Sunday morning. Okay. And we need some, okay, we need some scholarships. If some of you would, you love to do that, and I do too, so encourage you to help sponsor some of these kids. But this is what we're doing in lieu of our Disciple Now weekend. And then Upward Basketball, starting February the 1st, and you want to be sure and call Caitlin here on her cell phone and sign up for that. We're going to have a wonderful time together, and thank God we've got a gym to use for that special outreach ministry. How are y'all doing this morning? Woo, man, it's good to see all of you today, and we are loving worshiping together. I won't get you. You can't get up and hug one another yet. The day is coming. But I want you to shout hi to everyone across the, you know. All right. And we'll continue our time together.
There's a great song that says, there's a great hymn that says, "Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine." Let's stand together and sing all three verses.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song. Story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. All is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Sing that chorus again.
This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
This time. Father, as we come this morning, we have heavy hearts, Lord, for the condition of our people, of our illnesses, of our nation. Lord, we just ask that you would give us the strength to bear up. You have made the way, Lord. All we have to do is follow. Go with us now and guide us, and may our hearts be open this morning, Lord, to receive the message and instruction that you would have us to receive. Bless us and guide us in all that we do. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Comes to give you for all eternity. life is a struggle, and sometimes you're just holding on, but there is a Savior who's been walking by your side all along, and he is able to restore all that's broken and turn your sorrow to
with me, Lord Jesus. We want you to speak. We are hungry and thirsty to hear you, to understand your word, to sense your presence this morning, for you to customize this message to our individual journeys, to where we are in our walk with you. Lord, I'm just a vessel. I want to be used by you. Speak through me today. In your name I pray. Amen. We started a new series last Sunday we're mainly talking about what does it mean to be a Christian? What does it mean to be a follower of Jesus? You know, our culture, whether they're believers or not, talk a lot about that. There are a lot of people who, you know, love to claim that they are Christians, but what does that really mean? And so it's WWJD, what would Jesus do? Because what we want to do is we want to put on the attitudes and the actions of Jesus Christ. If we're going to proudly proclaim, I'm a Christian, then we need to understand what that means. And so we're starting a study on Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, chapters 5, 6, and 7 in the book of Matthew. And it's going to take us a while to journey through these scriptures, but hopefully when we get to the end of it, we'll come to understand more what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ, what it means to say we're a Christian, what it means to say that this nation is a Christian nation. I mean, this nation is only going to be a Christian nation if there are Christians that are leading it and a part of it. We learned last week, just in our study of a couple of verses, we started looking at the Beatitudes, and we learned that the Beatitudes are congratulations statements. They're basically saying, this is who you are. This is who you're supposed to be. It's a way to let us know what we want to be like. And there is that wonderful Greek word in there. I love the word makarios. Most of your translations, as you look at the Beatitudes, uses the word blessed. When I hear the word blessed, I can't but help think of my good friend Joe Menifee, who was in management of Pilgrim's Pride during the big collapse in 2008 when the company lost $800 million in 1 year and had to declare bankruptcy. And one by one, different ones were losing their jobs because of this. And there was the day that Joe's two bosses came unannounced into his office first thing in the morning. And they sat down in front of his desk and they said, Joe, how are you? And knowing what's coming, he said, I'm blessed. So they proceeded to tell him that he was going to be packing his things and that he was going to be leaving the company and he was going to no longer be needed. And Joe said, well, I appreciate all the years that I've been able to work with this company. It's been a long time. It's been a great ride. But can I do one thing on my way out the door? And they said, sure. And he said, can I pray for you? And then he prayed for the two men that just decided to let him go. See, that's what Jesus would do, which is so different from what the world would do and what pride inside of us. I'm sure he wanted to reach across that desk and slug him, you know. I don't know what he was feeling at that moment, but he was controlled by the Lord and by the Holy Spirit and was able to respond in a way that Jesus has taught us to respond. Makarios, blessed. Another translation, to be envied. Another translation, happy or spiritually prosperous. It's the idea that no one, no matter how mean they are, nothing can take away the joy of Jesus, the peace of Jesus Christ in our life, not even the disappointments of 2020. Then, as we look at these Beatitudes together, we see that the first four have to do with our relationship with God, and then the last four have to do with our relationship with each other. And you see this in so many times in Scripture. The Ten Commandments are divided that way. The first five are vertical. They're about God. The last five are about our relationship with each other. It's about loving Jesus with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and loving your neighbor as yourself. You can always divide just about everything in Scripture into those two categories. And then last week, we looked at the first two Beatitudes. The first one we learn is, blessed is the person who is absolutely spiritually destitute. Their self-denial rewards them with the kingdom of God. And then the second beatitude, we learn, blessed is the person who is brokenhearted, not over the injustices done to you, but the injustices done to others. Or even more important than that, brokenhearted over our own sin and the consequences that our sin causes. And I want us to continue this study, and let's stand together and read God's Word. Matthew chapter 5, we'll look at the first six verses. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him. He began to teach them. He said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Thank you. You may be seated. So the third beatitude here is the blessed joy of a God-controlled life. You know, in our modern world, the word meek is not a word that is used to describe a strong person. As a matter of fact, when our world talks about somebody being meek, our world is talking about someone who is spineless. But the Greek word here, praus, is basically saying it is a person who is always angry at the right time and never angry at the wrong time. You know, the Bible says there's a time to be angry. The Bible also tells us that we're not to ever let the sun go down on our wrath. So if that anger takes you through the night to the next day, then you can know right away that that anger is not of God. Aristotle said meekness is the balance between excessive anger and excessive angerlessness. Too much anger versus too little anger. It's referring to the attitude of being selfless. It's okay to be angry about the injustices that are done to others. But did you know that it's really not godly to be angry about injustices done to you? And I don't know about you, but that's usually what I get angry about. It's when I think someone's done something to me is when I get mad. Selfish anger leads to sin. We have to get rid of pride if we want to be like Jesus. Jesus was completely humble, and he took the things that were hurled at him in the right spirit, in the right attitude. So it's basically saying, blessed is the person whose instinct, whose every impulse, every passion is under control. This word in the Greek language was even used to explain how you would make your pet obedient to you. Now, we had a dog named Snapple, and we were told that since Snapple misbehaved so much, that he needed to go to obedience school. Well, I want you to know that I took Snapple to obedience school, and we failed miserably. Because all Snapple wanted to do was pick a fight with another dog. Snapple loved people, but could not stand other dogs. I mean, that's just was his personality. And apparently, I was really poor, and I did a poor job of making Snapple obedient. You know, I guess I wasn't it's just not in me to be as mean as you need to be, you know, and pull that choker collar, you know. And I mean, I never could get Snapple to heal. Snapple, when we go on a walk, would be out there dragging me, you know, just never, come on, dog, you know, just couldn't get the dog to do that. This verse here says that you would have a perfect dog, or you would be that perfect dog that would be in complete obedience to the master, because that's what it means to be self-controlled. You remember the fruits of the Holy Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and finally, self-control. You see, self-control seems like a physical impossibility. But the truth is, this scripture is saying, is blessed is the person who is controlled by God. Serving God, we find perfect freedom. Doing God's will, we find His perfect peace. This is the truest, the purest humility, where we are completely, we have gotten rid of all pride. Quintilian, the great Roman teacher of oratory, said, "They would no doubt be excellent students if they were not already convinced of their knowledge." There's nothing worse than a know-it-all, you know. Can you teach a know-it-all? Absolutely not. But isn't that our attitude sometimes, especially as we get older, because, you know, we've experienced life, you know. We've been through a lot of things. Well, you're not going to teach me, you young whippersnapper, anything new, because, you know, I've been there, done that, got the T-shirt. It's about humility. And without humility, there is no advancement in education. Without humility, there is no love. The beginning of love is understanding what I understood the day that I met Amy Amerson. And I said, I want her. My good friend that was standing next to me, I pointed to her and I said, I'm going to marry that girl someday. And he says, you don't have a chance. I knew he was right. But God is graceful. Without humility, there would be no spirituality. Spirituality begins with our realization that our weaknesses and our needs all must point to God. So meekness is the acceptance of the fact that I have so much more to learn. Meekness is the acceptance of the fact that I need to be forgiven. So blessed, happy, to be envious is the person who has the humility to know his own ignorance, his own weakness, his own need. It is this meekness that says we'll inherit the earth. Great people understand that their possessions, they understand that their intellect or their instincts or their impulses must be disciplined. Numbers 12:3 says this: Moses was a very humble man, more humble than anyone else on the face of the earth. Moses was the meekest man on the earth. It's recorded in Scripture. But he certainly was not spineless. He was a man who marched into the presence of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, and demanded, "Let my people go." He didn't go just once. He went over and over and over again, and he led the people up to the door of the promised land. This man had backbone, but God said he was the most humble man on the earth. Proverbs 16:32 says this: "Better a patient person than a warrior." one with self-control than one who takes a city. So, since the word meek may not communicate today, try this as a translation. To be envied is the person who is always angry at the right time, never angry at the wrong time, who has every instinct and impulse and passion under control because he himself is God-controlled, who has the humility to release his own ignorance and his own weakness. For such a person is king among men. Can you imagine if we really did have politicians that operated like Jesus? What would the conversations be like in Washington, D.C., if there was truly meek, humble men who were operating, and women, excuse me, who are operating our country? Thank you for ladies looking at me like that. Who do you know that is like this? So few aspire to be what the Scripture tells us that we should be. Proverbs 15:1 says, "A gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger." Hey, do you let people push your buttons? Facebook, social media. It's so easy to type and just let people have it, you know? I remember when email first came on the scene, I hardly email anyway. But, you know, I used to get these long emails. You need to do this, and you need to do that, and, you know, why didn't you do this? Why didn't you do that? You know, it was so uplifting. I remember commenting to one time, say, "Thank you for the encouragement. I appreciate it." I mean, we hide behind a computer screen and just say whatever we want. Is that what Jesus would do? The next time you post something on Facebook or write an email, ask, am I being meek? Am I being humble? I mean, it's one thing to debate issues and discuss things and everything, but that's not always what comes about. And man, sometimes we can just lamb blast each other, you know? And for what reason? I commented to someone the other day, have you ever changed one person's mind on Facebook? No, change anybody's mind. Everybody's just speaking their mind. All right, I'll get off my soapbox for a moment. Use godly restraint in everything we do. And then let's look at the next beatitude since we have time. The blessed joy of the starving spirit. You know, words don't exist in isolation. We see this all around us. They exist against a backdrop of our experiences. They have baggage with them. They have, political ramifications. You know, there's more and more buzzwords and politically correct words and phrases that can bring about heat and emotions. And this was very true about these Beatitudes when Jesus was speaking them for the very first time. Because who among us understands what it's really like to be hungry or to be thirsty? You see, the ancient world was totally different. In the ancient world, a man who lived in Palestine only ate meat once a week, and most people were near starvation all of the time. They didn't have running water in their houses where they could just turn the tap and the water would come and they could fill up their glass. It was very hard to find cold, fresh, clean water. So when Jesus said to hunger and thirst after righteousness, This wasn't a mid-morning snack or a cup of coffee or a glass of tea that we're talking about. What was meant here is, I've got to have it or I'm going to die. I want righteousness or goodness in my life so much that I'm desperate for it. Just like a starving man is desperate for food, just like a thirsty man is desperate for water. The person who is blessed is not the person here who achieves goodness, because we know that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and perfection comes on the other side of glory. It's the person who longs for it with all of their heart. If a person attains goodness, but in the end is still hungry and thirsty for it, this scripture says that they have enviable joy. The Greek here infers not just that I'm hungry and thirsty for it, but I want all of it. I want it completely. All the bread, all the water. So blessed are those who hunger and thirst for the entire righteousness, for the complete righteousness. See, we seldom do this. Either we're an honest, moral, decent person, but yet we could never go to that person to share with them our troubles and to get sympathy. Or you have another person who has all kinds of faults. They have bad language. They're a heavy drinker. They're a gambler. They have a hot temper. But yet they would give you the shirt on their back if you needed it. See, both of these are partial goodness. And this is a call for complete goodness, whole goodness. Blessed is the person who longs for total righteousness, just as a starving person longs for food, or a person dying of thirst longs for water, for that person will be truly satisfied. I mean, this is a person that's excited. This is a person that's enthusiastic about the things of God. You can't live without it. You've got to get it. And we are definitely in trouble if we think we've already got it. Didn't Jesus say in Matthew 6:33, seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. He said in Matthew 7:7, keep on asking, and you'll receive what you ask for. Keep on seeking, and you will find. Keep on knocking, and the door will be open to you. Makes me think of a couple of people that I've known in my life. One person was a man named Dick Gantenbein. I built my house across the street from him 20 years ago. He was not a believer, was not going to church. His wife was a believer. But I remember what he said very early on. If you don't bring your big Bible over here and preach to me, I won't throw my beer cans in your yard. And that's how we got started. That was our first conversation. And it took a while, but we would stand at the end of our driveways. Our driveways were almost directly across from each other. And I would just stand there and listen to Dick. And I would listen and listen. I'd say very, very, very few things. And then eventually, we got him to go to the Passion movie and just seeing the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross in that way humbly brought him to the Savior, and he was saved. And I never forget the day he said, can I come to your church? It's not very often in life that a pastor gets asked, can I come to your church? And he was baptized, and what we both didn't know is he had 7 years to live from that moment. And he became the most mature believer that I've ever known in those 7 years. He studied the Bible and studied the Bible and studied the Bible and studied the Bible. He had workbook after workbook after workbook. His Bible was all marked up. There were notes written everywhere because he was so hungry and so thirsty. He told me, he said, before Jesus came to my life, I was a walking dead man. Now I'm alive, and I want to know everything about it. And he left here suddenly, walking with God as he did. Then I think of another man, Lloyd Billups, who for 20 years of his life was a drug addict and an alcoholic. And I mean, when he found Jesus, he was on the bottom. And from then on, he would always tell me, I'm doing the Lloyd's work. And he would sponsor all of these people that were alcoholics and drug addicts, and he would point them to Jesus, and he'd work the 12 steps with them, and he would help them get out of the same jam that he was in. And again, he was always so hungry and thirsty to know more about the Lord, to advance in his spiritual development. That's what this beatitude is saying. That's what a follower of Jesus is. It's somebody that loves God with all their heart, mind, soul, and strength, and loves the Word of God, and loves to know Him, and to hear Him speak, and to carry out His instructions. Blessed is the person who hungers and thirsts after what's good. You know, we usually have the attitude, we just want to get by. Just be, you know, if tell me how I can be almost good enough, you know? As if we're working our way to heaven. Did anybody tell you can't work your way to heaven? Anybody tell you that there's no way that your good stuff's going to outdo your bad stuff and then you're going to get in? The only way to get in is because of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. You just believe in your heart that God raises from the dead and then you'll be saved. But then you don't just sit around and do nothing. Man, you want to thank the person that saved your life. Somebody, if you're out there drowning and somebody saves you, you're going to be indebted to that person for the rest of your life. I'm indebted to Jesus, and I want to know Him. I want to walk with Him. I want to know His Word, and I want to be like Him, and I want to have His humility, and I want to have my anger under control, and I want to stop being worried about when I think injustices are done to me and be concerned about the injustices that are done to other people, because it is all over the place, the injustices that are done to so many people. That, my friends, is what Jesus said is a blessed person. To be envied. Makarios. Happy. Spiritually prosperous is that kind of person. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you for your word. Help us to be enthusiastic, excited about knowing you, about spending time with you, about knowing your word, and about the things of God. More important than anything else in our life, Lord Jesus. Help us to want to have your attitudes and to take on your actions and to do our very best to be like you. God, we know that's a challenge. We know that we have a long way to go, but we know in the power of the Holy Spirit that we truly can live out the fruits of your Holy Spirit, and we can operate in the gifts of your Holy Spirit. So, Lord, I pray that today that we would lay down our pride and that we would humble ourselves before you and be sensitive to your Holy Spirit. For those who are listening to my voice today, either here in this room or on Facebook or on television, I pray that if they do not know you as Savior, that they would pray this prayer. Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I'm sorry for my sins. Please forgive me. Please come into my life. Become the most important person in my life, more important than my family or my friends or anything that I have. I love you, Jesus. Thank you for dying on the cross for me. If anyone pray that prayer, then I pray that they would come forward today. I pray that they would let us know that for the first time they've given their life to you. Thank you, Jesus. In your name I pray. Amen. Let's stand together. Let's worship.